So the first speaker in this second round will be Antonio Aguilu. He's a professor here at the university in the science and the engineering school. And he will give us another perspective about one of these social problems that the deputy has mentioned earlier, and how this problem is found and how it's solved. So, Antonio.
Thank you, Miguel. Thank you, Tony, Barbara.
That's it. Thank you, Tony, Barbara, and your team for inviting us and for your wonderful job at doing here in the university. Thank you, everyone. I don't know if it's going to be much interest in this case for you, but we are. What I can assure is that our experience does answer to the lemma of this event, at least in its Spanish meaning, with the hands in the dough. That was our intention since the beginning of the project, the experience team project I want to talk about. 6 years ago, when Lorena Fernandez, our digital identity director, and I were having a coffee here in the university, we were speaking about women digital gap, and in a couple of napkins, we took some notes of what today is this project. Our project foundation is reality. There are many facts we analyzed about the inequality of women and men in the technology world. I think it's not the main point of this session, so I just go over the topic. In all engineering studies, and mainly in computer science, which is the oldest of our engineering faculty studies here, we are not only seeing a progression, but a regression in gender balance. And that's not only a problem here, but in many places in the world. Almost every country concerned about technology is now worried about women being underrepresented in that field. As you see in the graphic, we were going down to 12% of women in some studies. And that's not only a problem for computer science, but for almost every professional area around science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. That's what formed some years ago the acronym STEM, and later STEAM in the A of arts, as an international area for action to revert this tendency, given the growing importance of technology in our lives and the importance for society to have gender-balanced professionals. As you see in the slide, more than 53% of women are great students in Basque Country, but less than 35% of STEAM students are women. Those numbers are very similar in other countries. U.S. is maybe the first country taking action on this problem, and we are happily starting to see now some minor changes in the good direction there. We are not much yet in that point here in Spain, in Europe. So I told you our project is fact-based, but we didn't want to make only voluntarism here, so we tried to make it also founded in research. This gender difference is not casual. There are a lot of known factors provoking it, so we try to design actions based on what research shows. And as you maybe know or imagine, this is a complex problem with many different sides. Girls don't know what exactly a tech job is, or the huge amount of possibilities of STEAM jobs in non-tech areas. There are many stereotypes affecting. They have few references of women in tech and science jobs. There's the Dunning-Kruger effect in the girls, making them underestimate their value and performance. Studies say that girls performing better than boys in science have worse self-concept for STEAM jobs. And so on. We don't forget that this is a problem not only of gender. Boys are also affected for some of these items, and research shows that socioeconomic, racial, and other differences also have impact in this gap. But we have started focusing on girls, and from there we are slowly trying to integrate other aspects. Here's our loved Carl. There are a lot of memes we could put here. The fact is that universities not only have to train in the subjects, in our vision, in these days we also have the mission of communicate to society the importance of training and specialization for present and future society. And all of this mixture is the starting point for our STEAM, Inspire STEAM project. So, what we do is an open call for professional women working in STEAM sectors. Of course, there are many people within different profiles that could be wonderful for the project, but due to the lack of references, we believe in making the most of this opportunity to put in girls' lives at least one particular and concrete reference, or women mentors. Our target group is 6 years of primary school, because the studies show that there's the start of a big turning point in girls' psychology and a good place to impact in future vocation. Schools are asking us a lot for sessions in secondary, for teenagers, and we are sure there are a lot of things we could do with them, but as I told you, we are doing little by little, trying to focus, analyze, and fix a particular action before starting new ones. The group at the school is split in boys and girls, and mentors have 6 sessions of 1 to 2 hours with only the girls, in size-limited groups. School teachers work with boys in the same material in that time. We previously work with mentors to understand the role of mentor in those sessions. They are not teachers. They are not the main role in the room. They are not there to speak about their lives or experiences. They are there to listen, to recognize or encourage personal aspects, to provoke dialogue and reflection, to scatter, to sow for the future. We also train the school teachers working with boys. Here you have the schematic of the 6 sessions. You see what is STEAM, stereotypes, careers, women in history, STEAM women now, and a closing session, STEAM girl. There are material, videos, activities working as an excuse to open the space and the time for the girls to wander. Mentors also have a bunch of instruments for that goal we have created in Inspira. There's a workbook for the girls, there are guides for each session for the mentors, and there's activities, guides, stickers, a digital community to share, and so on. Our mission is our start is seeing the goal of Inspira is to have more women engineers. Thinking about that, we knew at the start that this is not a good goal. It's necessary for society, maybe it's necessary for engineering schools too, but our mission for the girls and the boys is a little higher than that. We put our humble little action for that girl, for she can freely choose to be whatever she really wants or likes, not influenced by the stereotypes, by society, family, friends. We try to wake up a difficult little personal weapon for navigating the unconscious that frequently takes decisions for us. To structure all of this, as you can imagine, we have a lot of tasks to arrange. There are hundreds of people to organize, around 1,000 of finance girls and boys. Here you can see some of our main responsibilities. We have 5 people working in the project and a workload of more than 2,000 hours a year. And more agents in this project, the mentors, maybe the main agent with the girls and the boys. Here you can see how the project is growing. We are starting now the 3rd annual edition. We had 17 mentors the first, near 100 last year, and more than 200 this one. This same week we are having 6 different training sessions for new women mentors. Their work is voluntary. We cover travel costs, but there is no payment. They are excited now, but also scared the first time. The wonderful things of this project is how some spectacular things can happen with no exchange for money. The mentors used to say us at the end that they have learned more than the girls. Here you can see the numbers of schools, from 12 to more than 100 in these 2 years, and from 200 girls up to 2,000 girls and boys in these 2 years. We also have the expected numbers, who knows, in the future, it's going to evolve. We knew soon that companies around mentors could have a role in this project, and from second year we started signing agreements with involved companies. They cover the working hours, the mentors' dedication to Inspira STEAM, and make internal communication for new women for Inspira mentoring. Speaking about the stakeholders, one of the main points of these sessions, one fundamental reason for this project to exist is the possibility of financing it, as you know, almost every project. We have not an expensive project, there's no tech to buy, the mentors and the schools participate for free, But as you can imagine, doing this with the minimum quality needed would be impossible without economic resources. At this point, the best partners we found for financing are public institutions. The three provincial delegations of Basque Country, which is, believe me, I have to say, very unusual, quite unusual, to have them together in the same project. Have to also say that Teresa is here, that the Vizcaya provincial delegation is the first and the most important part, the first that believed in this project. We are here thanks to them. The Spanish Ministry of Industry for the first edition, and we recently signed an important collaboration with the BBK, local and national bank. We are starting this year to deal with these big companies, as Roche, which is already financing Catalonia site. I told you that we funded this project in facts and research. Our commitment is also producing facts and research to enrich the project and to enrich the community. It would be so incoherent to have a project about science with no science. I know we are passing pre and post tests of self-efficacy and technology affinity to participants and control groups, and a satisfaction survey to participants, schools, and mentors. We're also trying to organize longitudinal study over time. That's not easy due to personal data protection in non-adults and other factors. So apart from making all this well in our little vast territory, we have two other Inspira sites already working, what has made Eichenbeck a lot of time on defining the model, structuring a kind of franchise. We are starting to explore, as me, in 10 months, but we are afraid and also excited of having more than 10 in 1 year in Spain. And we even have contacts in Europe and Latin America for starting international experience. Little by little, but yes, you see, not so little. We have developed an agreement with the task and responsibility of this site, but these are talks to explain for our time. So if you need more particular information in this matter, please tell us and I'll be happy to send you more information. I finished telling you about a very emotional experience we had 2 months ago, the Inspira Manifesto, 7 public statements about technology and equality, where we declare our intentions not only for Inspira, but for other gender and tech projects we are doing. You can access it on the web in that link. You are invited to sign it if you agree with us on the importance on this topic. And finishing, the Spanish word Inspira has same root and almost same meaning that English inspire. Inspiration, as in the breath, as in the influence, motivation, guide. Around the Inspira project, all of us sometimes inspire others, but many more times we are inspired by others. In that touching and particular game of giving and receiving, we are. Thank you, everyone, for sharing this inspiration.
Well, thank you very much, Antonio, for this inspiring presentation. And I would like to quote a previous speaker that has said that the future can be built. So it's not that you don't know that you will achieve 6,000 people, but you can just work on that and maybe make it happen, hopefully. Mm-hmm. Okay, and now we will just move to the last presentation of this panel, where we have also the representative of the administration, in this case, the Provincial Council of Guipúzcoa, that we have the opportunity to welcome Maite Peña, that is the deputy for social issues, for social policies. And we have, again, an expert that has combined social policy in the administration and at the academia, that is Felix Arrieta, that is currently the head of the Deusto Forum in the San Sebastián campus. So I leave you the floor. Maite will give her presentation in Spanish, but then we will have Felix that will be translating that or making a summary into English. You'll have the presentation in English, all of you, after the presentation.
Thank you very much. Last but not least, I hope. Thank you for inviting us. It's a pleasure for us to be here. In 2016, the Provincial Council of Guipúzcoa and Deusto signed an agreement for cooperation in social policies and in social issues. It was 2 years ago, but for us it's been like a lifetime cooperation, because since then I always say that it's like living and cooperating and sharing like a vision of what policies have to be and where we want to go together. We have been working since then on more than 5 different projects, developing together and with the same goals and the same perspective. The first one is public and private cooperation, and the second one is action research. We are both convinced that that's the way we have to work, and not only the public administration and the university, but both the NGOs of the territory and the companies and the private companies that are working on the territory on the same fields we are working. So that's the spirit of the project. Now Maite is going to tell you we are constructing policy together, we are constructing knowledge together, and for us this is very important, and this is an opportunity, a unique opportunity of making this kind of policy. The Addenberry project, and now Maite is going to tell, is a project for the elderly. We have, for me, an opportunity but a problem too in this territory, in Gipuzkoa and in Vizcaya and in the Basque Country and in Spain and in all Europe maybe, and maybe in all the world. We are getting older, and that's good news. We are getting older, we live more, we are getting, but of course young people are many less in this territory, and we have to learn and we have to think how are we going to care and how are we going to, what are we going to do with elderly in the ways when they get, when they can't be at home, and what kind of care are we going to get them. So Addenberry project is a social care project, but also an economic development project. They are combined there. And this is a project we have worked from university, from the public administration, from Diputación de Gipuzkoa, the Gipuzkoan Council, from Tecnalia, that is an economic technological industry, from Fundación Matia, and it's an NGO in Gipuzkoa, from Fundación SIS, that is a research institute, and all of us working together, that believe me, it's not easy, because each one of them, of us, sorry, has our expectations, our goals, but I'm quite happy with the results. I was in Colombia last week, and a friend of mine there says that when a project goes well, it's un proyecto muy ganador. And I think that this project is muy ganador. Believe me, it was not easy in 2016, but I think that, as Maite is going to say now, it's quite ganador. So, thank you.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you for you inviting us to this interesting this seminar. Egunon guztioi. Bueno, proyecto ganador, ha puesto las expectativas feliz muy altas. Yo voy a intentar, porque es importante situar un poco el contexto, ¿no? Sobre todo normativo, del que pende este proyecto ganador, para que se vea que es una manera de hacer y no es un proyecto aislado, ¿no? Tenemos en Gipuzkoa un plan estratégico de gestión 2015-2019, que, bueno, aparte de un modelo diferente de gobernanza, sí que se ha dotado de los recursos necesarios para escuchar a la ciudadanía y vincular los intereses del territorio con la línea de acción política. ¿Y dónde están los intereses del territorio? Los intereses del territorio están donde lo señalan sus empresas, sus entidades sin ánimo de lucro, sus ciudadanos. O sea, hemos establecido todo un proceso de escucha participativa para detectar hacia dónde tenemos que ir en función de dónde están las necesidades en atención a los intereses del territorio. Pero además, no desde un plano teórico, sino desde un plano de acción, a través de la experimentación, con contraste de los resultados, ¿no? El programa, la iniciativa se llama Etorkizuna Eraikiz. Esto marca las líneas de actuación de la Diputación Foral de Gipuzkoa hasta 2025 y Adinberri, este proyecto ambicioso, está incluido aquí. ¿Y por qué decimos que lo necesitamos? Porque necesitamos hacer frente al reto del envejecimiento de la población, ¿no? En todos los países desarrollados se está transformando la sociedad. Los paradigmas actuales, tanto de configuración social como económica y de crecimiento sostenible, nos llevan a una situación nueva, ¿no? Por ejemplo, en Gipuzkoa, veis ahí el dato, en 2017 el 35% de la población tiene más de 55 años. Hay que tener en cuenta que somos un territorio de 713.000 habitantes y está previsto que para el 2031 este porcentaje se incremente hasta el 46,5%, ¿no? Bueno, pues esto es muy importante y un dato todavía más importante y es que el 5% de estas personas van a tener 85 años, según datos del USTAT, con lo cual nos va a requerir, bueno, pues un cambio sociológico muy importante y también unas necesidades de atención muy importantes, ¿no? Bueno, 29.000 personas van a tener tienen hoy en día un grado de dependencia en Gipuzkoa y para el 2031 39.000 personas esperan. Esto, bueno, pues parece que asusta, ¿no? Pero es también una oportunidad, como decíamos. Bueno, la mayoría de las personas van a vivir su situación, ¿no? Su vida en una situación de autonomía funcional y relacional, pero 39.000 van a tener un grado de dependencia variable y esto hoy nos va a suponer también un importante salto en el presupuesto. Hoy en día ya el 48% del presupuesto de la Diputación Foral de Gipuzkoa, 380 millones, están dedicados a las políticas sociales, 525 euros por persona. Y esto también hay que tenerlo en cuenta. Por lo tanto, nos encontramos ante un reto de primera magnitud, ¿no? Para mejorar, tanto desde la perspectiva asistencial, para mejorar la calidad de vida de las personas y la atención de las mismas, como desde una perspectiva social, por lo que va a cambiar el panorama, como desde una perspectiva económica, ¿no? Esto es lo que nos ha llevado a ver como una oportunidad la mejora de la salud y también la creación de un ámbito económico vinculado al mundo del envejecimiento y de la prestación de servicios. Es indudable que estas personas van a necesitar nuevos servicios, nuevos recursos y que desde luego hay que explotar, ¿no? En este escenario es donde planteamos la estrategia Adinberri con el propósito de maximizar el potencial de innovación de Gipuzkoa para los servicios de envejecimiento saludable y con un objetivo de extender el periodo de vida saludable. Los objetivos serían mejorar la salud y la calidad de vida de la ciudadanía, poniendo el foco en las personas mayores, contribuir a la excelencia y la sostenibilidad a largo plazo en el servicio de atención y cuidados y mejorar la competitividad de la industria vinculada a las personas mayores a través de nuevos productos y servicios que se expanden en el mercado. Es una estrategia transversal. Aquí no está solamente políticas sociales y es el gran salto. Está también el Departamento de Promoción Económica e Innovación y el área del Diputado General, con lo cual requiere trabajar de manera coordinada el ámbito económico, el ámbito de la innovación y el ámbito de los servicios sociales. Los componentes principales de la estrategia son los que tenéis aquí. En primer lugar, un centro de referencia de atención a personas en Pasaia va a estar. Esto es una residencia, que es lo más visible, pero no es lo único, igual para en muchas ocasiones tampoco lo más importante. El segundo componente es un polo tecnológico de investigación aplicada de carácter abierto, colaborativo y capaz de vincular la actividad asistencial de la salud, la gestión del conocimiento y el desarrollo tecnológico e industrial en materia de envejecimiento en Guipúzcoa. El tercer elemento muy importante para nosotros es una agenda estratégica de innovación desde la que se generará transferencia de conocimiento, apoyo empresarial y el impulso a la demanda. Hay una fundación también, un ecosistema sanitario y, por último, tenemos unas ayudas económicas a proyectos de innovación. La fundación, bueno, se va a centrar en el impulso y despliegue de la estrategia orientada a la innovación y, como decía, impulsar productos y servicios innovadores en espacios compartidos. Las características es, bueno, va a ser pública y abierta, participación privada, un equipo de trabajo reducido. No queremos tampoco hacer macroestructuras, queremos hacer algo colaborativo con los demás, pero que no nos requiera una estructura muy grande. Una gobernanza, luego veréis, de trabajo conjunto muy complicada. Y algo que para nosotros es muy importante, la experimentación activa. Bueno, la estrategia pretende dar respuesta al desafío del envejecimiento, convirtiéndolo en una oportunidad desde una doble visión, la visión social, como decía, y también la visión económica, investigación, innovación, y tratar de convertir al territorio que tiene potencial en un referente en el sector de las biociencias. Vemos oportunidades, las que vamos a trabajar son el hogar para la longevidad. Hablábamos de trabajar el envejecimiento desde una perspectiva transversal. El hogar para la longevidad es una de ellas. Bueno, es lograr que personas consigan estar en su domicilio, extender esas oportunidades. Bueno, se trata de domótica inteligente, nuevos modelos de convivencia, vivienda adaptada, servicios avanzados en el hogar. Lo que sí tenemos muy claro es que el 80% de las personas que están atendidas quieren ser atendidas en sus domicilios. Y a esto también hay que darle una respuesta, y es un modelo bien interesante. La segunda oportunidad son los cuidados y atención. El objetivo en este ámbito de trabajo es innovar en los servicios de cuidado. Vamos a centrar la atención en la persona, tanto en el ámbito domiciliario como también en el residencial, mirando hacia un modelo más doméstico y menos hospitalario. El entorno para la longevidad habla de espacios públicos que se adapten a las necesidades de las personas que fomenten a extender su etapa activa, su etapa con ausencia de dependencia. Hablamos de transporte adaptado, entorno amigable, logística, micromovilidad, orientación. Envejecimiento de valor, bueno, pues aquí supone una oportunidad muy grande, ¿no? Las personas cada vez vivimos más, pero cada vez llegamos mejor también al final de nuestra vida, y hay un periodo que tiene mucho que aportar a la sociedad y hay que canalizar toda esa aportación, ¿no? Sistemas de aprendizaje, sistemas de soporte laboral, es lo que trabajaremos aquí. Y por último, penúltimo, el envejecimiento activo. Bueno, creación de productos y servicios que lo fomenten y que lo desarrolle. Para esto es imprescindible conocer la voz de los usuarios y de los familiares. Hay que tenerles en cuenta y hay que canalizar toda esa información hacia las empresas que van a trabajar en la investigación, ¿no? El envejecimiento saludable, alimentación, es el último de los ámbitos. Tenemos un programa de ayudas y subvenciones, 1 millón hemos puesto en marcha para fomentar la investigación y la innovación. Se van a subvencionar actividades de desarrollo experimental, las de investigación, desarrollo e innovación empresarial y las de investigación cooperativa entre empresas y otras entidades del sistema sociosanitario. Hemos cerrado ya la convocatoria del 1 millón de euros y tengo que decir que hemos superado con creces las expectativas, ha habido mucha participación y lo vamos a tener verdaderamente complicado para elegir los proyectos. Hablábamos de los componentes, la fundación era uno de ellos, el ecosistema sociosanitario es otro de los componentes, con vocación de constituirse a medio o largo plazo como un clúster especializado en el desarrollo de las oportunidades, ¿no? El modelo de gobernanza, hablábamos, es francamente complicado. Aquí está, aquí veis todos los agentes que participan. Señalaba Félix, Deusto, por supuesto, es un socio privilegiado, preferente, Tecnalia también, pero de lo que se trata es de que todo el territorio se vea incluido en esta estrategia, no que haya compartimentos estancos, de tal manera que todos los prestadores de servicios, todas las residencias, vean esto como su proyecto y haya un flujo de información en las necesidades y las propuestas de soluciones muy continuo. Y lo mismo con las empresas, el ámbito de las empresas, el ámbito de las universidades. Bueno, esto es fácil poner los redondeles, es un poco más complicado luego gestionar la gobernanza. Aquí tenemos aquí está parte de la dificultad, pero estoy segura que seremos capaces de estar a la altura. Tejer redes, como decía, de colaboración con agentes que se engloban en 6 ámbitos. Tercer sector, el sector sociosanitario, agentes innovadores, educación, administraciones públicas, universidades y, como no, las empresas. Luego, decía que igual es lo más visible, lo que parece más importante, pero como veis es algo que es verdaderamente transversal. El centro de referencia en atención avanzada se va a centrar en las necesidades de las personas, incorporando esa óptica, no dejándolas de lado, tienen opinión, ven sus necesidades y la deben de compartir, ¿no? Este centro será una referencia y un aglutinador de los agentes que conforman el ecosistema Adinberri. ¿No más? Bueno, os explico. Se va a encontrar en Pasaya y va a tener una unidad de innovación. Va a haber una residencia en la que va a tener mucha importancia la construcción y el espacio físico ya volcado desde el inicio a la atención y a la innovación en la atención. 120 plazas residenciales, 25 apartamentos tutelados, centro de día, un espacio muy importante para la innovación, 500 metros. Esto es lo que tenemos, lo que estamos desarrollando, porque como veis la construcción todavía no está, estamos dando los pasos, pero todo el engranaje está ya puesto en marcha y yo creo que vamos a contribuir a que el nivel de especialización en Guipúzcoa de productos, servicios y soluciones ligadas al envejecimiento y a las tecnologías sanitarias beneficie a todo el territorio, también en lo económico, porque es un ámbito muy importante de economía emergente y se elegirá como referente en los campos de experimentación avanzada. Este es el proyecto ambicioso que señalaba Félix y desde luego que tenemos que decir que estamos contando con la colaboración de todo el mundo, instituciones, empresa privada, universidades y que tenemos muchas expectativas aquí puestas.
Just to resume, that there are 6 programs in Adinberri. A residence for elderly care, that is, as Meite said, the main photo of the program. An innovation center, just behind the residence, and they are going to be in Pasaya. Pasaya is a village, not a small, really, a village in Guipúzcoa, where the port is, and it's been traditionally like a industrial part of Guipúzcoa, and now the goal of the project is to regenerate the village. So this project wants to be a part of that regeneration. So the residence and the innovation center goes in there in Pasaya, in Trincherpe, a foundation who wants to make this complex governance of all the agents of the territory who works with the elderly, a competitive program for all these agents to work in this area, an ecosystem for social and sanitary attention, which is not easy because, as you have seen just this morning, we have three provincial councils here, Gipuzkoa, Maite, Vizcaya, Teresa La Espada, who was just here, and Álava, who work on the social care, and the Basque government, who works on sanitary care. So coordinating that is not really an easy fact, but I'm not going to speak now about that, but it's not easy. So that's another goal of the project. So these are the areas in Adinberri, and we have been for a long time constructing them, and I think that, as I said before, it's an interesting project, and we will continue working together on that. Thank you.